copiar. Baño brazo, te va a ir. Debe estar con motivation. Then come from the request for subject. So let M be a smooth compact manifold. So variable, or differentiable. Then it is well known by taking the root that the difference between rationalized K theory of M, I mean the topological K theory of M is just a manifold, and cohomology of M is perfectly well known. Now the question is, suppose that the final group X on M, so we want a G equilibrium inversion. For now I just discuss some request. So what is the G equilibrium, what is a correct G equilibrium inversion of this? Well, the left hand side is resonatory, it's resonatory to consider equilibrium K theory, so equilibrium vector bundle. Consider equivariant K theory. And we can consider a map. So the first naive guess is just to take equivariant cohomology. You do have with integral coefficients and even more with rational coefficients, you have equivariant cohomology defined by say Parasol function. But with few coefficients know that these are just nothing but G variants of cohomology of the initial manifold, and this is not an isomorphism at all, not at all. So for example, let's take M to be a point, then on the left hand side, what is on the left hand side? So G equivariant ring of a point is a representation ring of our group. While on the right hand side, you see you can just completely changed. And this was a method as far as I understand by Atia and Siegel in their joint paper in 1989.
Excuse me, the first where it's in so it's period, I mean you have star, right? It's two periodic, right? You do consider
it is two periodic, yeah. Well let me skip the issue about indices, but yeah, all right, it's two periodic and the zero part corresponds to the sum of all
even
dimensional and the yeah.
Okay.
So it's complex K theory. Right? Complex K theory, yes, because the vector bundles, C vector bundles of M. This is. So now the idea how to modify the right hand side. And this is what is also sometimes called the orthofold cohomology, because they are adequate for the orthofold here. So these are defined, also this was known, maybe the construction was known to someone else, and in some other sources it is called an extended closure, say, by Baum. So, the theory is easy. Let M tilde be the set of couples A and G, where G of X equals X. So, it's a subset in M times G. take G invariant, and then we take the growth of central vector. So C of G is the quantity is equal in G, and G of G is the central vector. Regular So I assume that the order is comprised with the characteristic of the field. And also, possibility assume that K contains all n roots of unity. One can consider a more general situation, but possibility assume this. This is how it was in, well, history also considered some more general case. But. So then history proved the following. In Randall Sula for that, in 81. Geology study proved that compared to isomorphism of G equivalent K theory of X with coefficients, so one inverts M first. There was even C, so it was more up. And one also adds N primary root of unity. And then there is an isomorphism between this and similar the right hand side, so one considers K theory. With the same coefficient.
Is it now algebraic K theory?
Yes, for sure. I mean now algebraic K theory.
So
now it's an algebraic scope.
Use the same notation.
And I use the same notation, yeah, I just wanted to comment it. So I use the same notation for the extent portion. You can see it's purely categorical, so it doesn't matter that consists.
Oh,
just the same definition, the K theory of algebraic correctness. And the same decomposition. So I take the quotient as a variety. So
yeah, notation for K theory is the same.
Yes, so it's,
that
it's,
that
it's a different context, sorry, but that's not at least not to talk anyway. So yeah, it's still there is this formula, so this we have these quotients, which are well, if you suppose that our variety is quasi projective, then they are also quasi projective, right? Possibly single. Okay. So now when one sees a formula like that, one would like to see something in between, yes? So one has a geometry. So on geometry, one has a geometrical path, so to say, and one has a cosmological path. And here one has some varieties, or actually here we consider what we consider here is a stack, the rim of a stack. One can reinterpret it like that. So varieties of stacks. One can consider isomorphism between them. And here one has cohomology theory. So like K theory, the Bose cohomology, yes, we recommend it. Or K models. So actually this formula, yeah, sorry, I forgot to say that. This formula was also generalized by Baranovsky, not generalized, but a version by Baranovsky for Bose cohomology. And then it was also proved for arbitrary degree muffin stacks instead of global quotients by finding proof by Toyen. For arbitrary degree muffin stacks. In his very beginning, when he was proving Riemann-Roch for degree muffin stacks.
Wasn't there some work by all these people who go on?
By whom?
Go on.
Yeah, I don't claim that there is a big amount of classes of the cohomology.
Well, that's what's kind of given before the cohomology.
In the algebraic, same. Doesn't be something that, because in the algebraic, the tends to be the first.
Yeah.
For the Riemann perspective. No, yeah, it's possible that they skip some other. So this formula is algebraic setting, I think. This. And then there was also, there is a recent paper by Tabuada and Michel Vanderbilt. And they actually proved that the k-modus is the same. So the k-modus of this quotient in the right steps and the k-modus of all this are the same, but all this with these coefficients, with all these invert coefficients, which is extremely
important.
K-modus. Well, it's
k-modus.
K-modus. That's what Tabuada calls the non-commutative modus. Actually, k-modus of right. So here we have some k-modus, some cohomological invariants, here we have a right. So even for the case when x is a point, we already see that this isomorphism doesn't come from any isomorphism between geometric objects. Of course, the quotient stack point over G is not isomorphic at all. So here on the right hand side, we have just the joint union of points, yes? Over C and G. So we don't have any isomorphism between all the geometric stacks. Here, they're definitely not isomorphic. However, still, we have some isomorphism of cohomology. So, an initial attempt is to find something in between, such as to link the more geometrical side towards geometry, to read this as orders towards geometry. And I guess maybe everybody sitting this orders could immediately say that one should consider the right case, which is right in between geometry and various homological theories. So it's natural to consider the right categories in the loop. That's something similar happened on the level of the right categories. And this was done, analyzed in the paper by Sasha Bishop and Michel Vandermeer, inside the conjecture of that paper. So there are a lot of possible things in the paper, but this is just a conjecture. But before, let's consider a very simple example. It's also it's a particular case of what Sasha was considering yesterday in his talk also. So let's consider just the quotient of P1 of a cyclic group. And assume the field is algebraically closed, so this contains the group of unity, so a point x goes just to the different x. This would be our x under the g. So what can be said about, first let's consider the extended portion. What is the extended portion in this case? So I erased on the same place there was a formula about the disjoint tuning, and one can easily see that it's a disjoint tuning of Q1 when one considers the trivial of this class to give P1. The simple edge of the natural element is the whole P1, the quotient will be again the P1, because P1 over is P1. And all the rest of a non-trivial elements in the secret group, the invariants are just 2 points. So it will give us 2n minus 1 or 2n minus 2 points. And well, what about category of Hermitian sheaves? So it's just a category of Hermitian sheaves on P1. And category of vector spaces taken 2n minus 2 times. On the other hand side, let's consider the quotient stack. What about category of Hermitian sheaves on it? So one can show, it's a particular case of general Gilagas theorem, for example, which tells you that if one has a semi-orthogonal or an exceptional collection of variety, and then G preserves the semi-orthogonal decomposition of strong exceptional collection or exceptional collection, then you also get a semi-orthogonal decomposition for the quotient stack. So for P1, one has O1. So here one can see that here one has a semi-orthogonal decomposition given by O1. And then by increase by all possible characters of the cyclic group. They actually just orthogonal, each couple to each other couple is just orthogonal. Let x be G final group, and suppose that Gx, now a condition on x, effective. And then I will comment where it is important.
Effective.
And suppose that for any, also, suppose that for any G, the quotient, which are components of the system quotient, are all smooth. Then, projectivity is not the problem here. Then, there exists a semi-orthogonal decomposition. Three-dimensional module of the model is a 5 by 3. So I let G be the semi-direct product. So what has it? Now I will consider some variety with the free action of H. With the free action of H. But still I will consider G covariant shift. And I will get a contradiction with this. So the variety is as follows. So let this is about the groups. Now the variety, let P be a generic, a general elliptic curve. Let's say over an algebraic equals to for simplicity. Actually one can explicitly give a finitely many, so one excludes finitely many J variants. One can explicitly say which. So when we go to this effect. Then let a G, so H X freely on E by transition, by translation. Yes, so we have n torsion. Yeah, n is always proprietary to the coefficient on the field. So one has the torsion in the subscript E, which is precisely H, so H X by transition. And G X through
right, there is n cube components and here on a something with it. It should be the coordinate of M, the kernel of the action, right? Because this is an element, which is MQ.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, you're right. Yes, sir. But it doesn't matter what. I claim that it's just your key.
Yes.
This is. But the problem, no, the point is that if the elliptic QFAI, since the elliptic QFAI is not isomorphic to E, it cannot be. The derived category is also not equivalent by a lot of tools from our loss theorem. Which shows that if you have two elliptic curves with equivalent derived categories, then the square of one curve is isomorphic to the square of the other curve. And one can show that this is impossible. Because, yeah, well, I can just show you. For this addition, one also uses that the curve doesn't have complex multiplication. Yeah, or that way it doesn't solve problems without complex multiplication. So this example shows that it is really important that the action is effective. Okay, so now let me pass to the main result. So the result was trying to prove something similar, but not for the categories themselves, but for their classes in K0 derived categories. One can first test the same question for classes in K0 derived categories. And here one has something positive, but under different assumptions. And we have a guess, we have a code that perhaps it would be helpful to prove this kind of texture also. But with, I mean, with QFE, not as a bit, but with QFE in K0 derived categories, the G categories. So now main result. So let me recall what is K0 of varieties. So K0 of varieties is a Frege-Gehring group generated by isomorphic classes of varieties. One of the Cisser's relations, which tells that the class of X equals the class of Z plus the class of U, where the Z inside X is closed. Use the common. This is a very well known ring, especially for recent day. So, then a very important result by Beta tells that this ring is isomorphic to another ring generated just by isomorphic classes of smooth projective varieties. Modular, completely different relation, so modular blow-up relation. That the blow-up of x minus the class of the exceptional divisor equals the difference x minus e. Where, so z inside x is smooth, and e inside blow-up is the exceptional divisor. Clearly, this relation holds here, because the component is the same. So one has definitely a map from here to here, and the point is that this is an isomorphism. And this holds for weak factorization theorem. Okay, so now.
So we now assume that the characteristic is zero.
Yes, now I assume that it is. Okay. Thank you very much. Now, okay, it is important. Now, for the whole student, until the rest, we will assume that it is. So, now we also want the G equivalent version, which was also described by Peter himself. So, let G be a finite group, G equivalent version. So, we fix a group for now. We can see that there's a lot like that, which is the same as but isomorphic classes of varieties with an action of G, model the same system relations, and just let me write it to show this notation. So let the note like that, the class of X with the action of a group G, not of a G. And the same beta isomorphism with the of G acting on X smooth projection. Let me repeat, so blow up relation. G equivalent blow up relation. The proof is completely the same just because this weak factorization is equivalent to this factorial, so it's equivalent with respect to any action of the group. Fixed proof. Okay, so now let me also remind briefly what is a K0 DG category. So But in principle, let's consider good quality. It will be important for us that we consider all the geometric DG category. So we call the definition by law that the geometric DG category, so let M be a DG category. Okay, so it is geometric. If it's H0, it's an admissible subcategory in the right category of some smooth projective. Right. Particularly it is pre-calculated. Now let's define a zero of geometric DG categories. Similar as here, so these are quasi-equivalence classes of geometric DG categories. Modular, and here we consider the same thermal decomposition relation, so n equals the sum of n prime plus and double prime, where we have a semi-total decomposition, so it's not of n, but a semi-total decomposition by it's not of n prime and it's not of n double prime. This is a definition by Bondel, Larson, and Kunz. And in this version. And a theorem, by the theorem by them, is that there is a categorical measure. There is a unique categorical measure from K0 varieties to this K0 of DG categories. Let me put geometric. Which sends a class of a smooth projective variety, but smooth projective, to the class of its derived category, or its DG category. And so in that paper there was used some particle enhancement, but then there was a paper by Arloff and Bulls where it was proved that the units of DG enhancement are the quasi equivalence. So doesn't matter which enhancement did they. Some DG enhancement of the derived category. So we can, if you are not familiar with DG categories, you can consider all this as derived categories of vector shift, and this will be not so far from the truth. Okay, so but what is important here is that X is smooth projective. So if you have an arbitrary variety, you should express it as a linear combination by using this sister solution, a linear combination of smooth projective varieties. It's very similar to what happens with Hodge theory when we represent, let's say, an open variety as a open inside a smooth projective with a single normal crossing device at the boundary. But here you don't take first factors, you take classes of direct categories of vector. And the point is that, so due to Peter, the only relation one needs to test is this blow up relation. And this was proved by our work. And another theorem by Lutz and Schnurr tells that if X is smooth projective and G is a fine group, then the direct category of the quotient set is geometric.
No, but also them. Also them.
For the global quotient, wasn't just you two?
Ah, okay.
But no, I discussed
it. It's based on the results.
Yeah, no, it is not based. No, in the case of the global. Ah, I'm sorry, you proved that it's a theorem. Yes, sorry. Yeah, you're right, yeah, sorry.
And then it's more general.
Yeah. I mean, you proved that it's saturated, but not yeah. For geometry, it's even better. Yeah, sure.
Sorry. It was for a smooth Galilean matrix X. Smooth Galilean matrix X.
No, yeah, there's also some great for smooth Galilean. Okay, so it's geometric. So now it follows that we have a map, let's call it UG, from K0 of G equivariant varieties to K0, to the same K0 of geometric DG categories, which sends the class of FG, where X is smooth projective again, to any GK enhancement. Also, there is some theorem about unicity of DG enhancement for smooth Galilean matrix X also. So, to DG enhancement of this category. And so, likewise, here it was used Arloff to show that blow up relation. Satisfied here. here you use the latest version again of so our log plus the length. So we have some G period thing here. Okay, so now let me move on. How many times do I have to?
10 minutes.
So now we are ready already to state the question. It's a much more question than the question raised above by Richard Vandenberg, not about Haskins, but about their class. About their class. So the question is compare mu g of x and mu of the extended quotient. So they give the same thing, but namely in K0 the GK. So let's close out. We have mu g of x, which is the class of the g pair we are catching when x is not projected. Or is this well defined for any class project or in just variety open singular with an extra g? We have this there, mu g of x, which leaves the k0 to gk. On the other hand side, you can take the quotient, which is some possibly singular, some quasi project, just variety. It also has a class mu in k0 to gk. Right here. And it's natural to consider to compare them in the light of what was said above.
So you remove the condition of efficient action and smoothness of the condition.
Yeah, now there will be an answer in some case. But not about smoothness, not in the smoothness condition. The condition will be different.
Neither efficient action.
Hmm?
Neither efficient action.
So?
The action is efficient. Effective.
Not this. You will see the condition. Now I'm going to the condition. So before I state the result, I may say a lemma, very simple geometric lemma. So that as above, let g, x, and x, then there is a finite specification by opening the closed subset. It's quite obvious. The specification, g covariant, very specification. Such that each strata is the induction from some group G lambda or some variety Y lambda with an action of G lambda, where the action is as follows. So one has an index sequence, all them are finite groups. And H lambda, G lambda, acts on Y lambda through a free action of H lambda. So it's a just several last exercise that even any variety with an action of G, one can always find a specification like that.
Can you explain this notation in
so I claim the specification is full. So each strata is induced from some subgroup. Well, you have, so for each strata, you have some subgroup G lambda, and you have some extra variety Y lambda, with an extra, such that your strata is G variant, isomorphic, as a G variant variety.
It's product Y lambda times.
Ah, yeah, I'm sorry, the question was about the HD, I'm sorry, yeah, sure, it's a product, yes. I didn't listen to the question. Yeah, it's a product.
Which means the quotient of the product by G lambda.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Sorry. Yes. Is this. And the equation of G lambda for lambda is quite simple. So it is always free. It's free modulo subkernel, which doesn't affect at all.
So is it unique kernel?
You have a maximal one. You have a, it's very easy. It's very complicated. Now, to the theory. Suppose, now I use the notation of lambda. Suppose for any lambda g from lambda, so take, suppose there is a specification, or actually it's enough to claim it for some specification or for maximal. So suppose there is a specification, let's say, for any lambda from lambda, defined over k. For example, in the field, I mean, if the field is not very closed, there is no this condition in the case of when k is not closed. Each useful k bar representation of another is defined, so all representations are defined over our field. Then there is a H lambda equivariant bijection between the set of conjugate classes and lambda and the set of irreducible representations of lambda. So, given an exact sequence like that, we have an action of H lambda both on the set of irreducible representations of lambda by conjugation and also on the set of conjugacy classes. It's well known that they have the same amount of elements, and you do have an isomorphism, but the isomorphism is something linear, it's not a bijection. You always have an H invariant isomorphism between vector spaces if you take the vector space spent by them. But you don't have a canonical bijection set. Moreover, this fails in the example that I cited above. This fails. This was presented in the issue of the example.
Yes, sir. What is the right hand side?
The set of irreducible representations of a lambda.
How this can say about linearity if it's about sets?
No, I mean, if you take the k vector spaces generated by the set, then between these two k vector spaces,
you always have
a canonical isomorphism given by a trace of representation. And this functorial, so it is H invariant. But between sets, you don't have, in general, you don't need to have an H invariant. Now, there's that condition that representation of n lambda in the direct sum of all irreducible representations extends to a representation of g lambda.
Which representation?
So, you have an action of n lambda, the direct sum of all of its irreducible representations. Yes? And the requirement is that this action extends and prolongs it to an action of the whole group zero.
So, every representation you take will definitely be density 1, yeah?
With 1, yeah, it's very important, yes. If you allow yourself to take arbitrary amount of pieces, then it's always useful, yes. But some of the pieces, it must always extend.
And how the third condition is related to the second?
It's a completely unrelated condition. Moreover, I will give you two examples. Well, they are not equivalent at all. No. Suppose that there is three conditions as this one. And then I claim that there is one, and then there is this equality. This is the result. Well, let me first, let me just give two examples and then discuss a corollary. So, actually, one example was already above.
So, there are no conditions about that stem, only about the groups.
Right. It's a group condition. And I don't think it is equivalent to the court. I don't think this is not bad at all. These are sufficient conditions. But, as an example, so I remember that it was a group. The modem taken twice and H the modem taken third as above. So yeah, let's enumerate that. So this is called zero condition, that I and Y. So Y holds because it's a semi-direct product. Whenever we have a semi-direct product, we can always use the representation. If it is equivariant, then it should be equivariant. So for semi-direct products, it mostly satisfies this condition, but this is not. However, we were not able to prove that in this was a counterexample to the equivalence between categories, which doesn't mean that it is a counterexample to this equality. So we were not able to show that one doesn't have this equality in that case of elliptic curves. However, there is another example when condition 2 is not satisfied, but.
Sorry, it was two negations, so can you say straightforward? Two negations is too much for math.
So, I mean, based on this group.
I'm saying about this example, you say.
the elliptic curve.
With elliptic curve.
With the elliptic curve. So here, this condition is satisfied. This condition is not satisfied.
I don't know if the
this a priori this doesn't mean anything, but it was a hint how to find a counterexample to Plessy van der Broek conjecture. And
so this, in this case, do you have this equality?
No. And yeah, so about the equality, we don't just don't know. We know that this gives a counterexample to the conjecture about the occurrence of cases.
It does give.
It does give a counterexample to conjection about
if you don't assume the action
effect. Well, this guy's are equal or not?
For that case, the ridiculous, we don't know. But now I give another example. Well, we do know that they are different. So another example. This will be an example opposite. When 2i doesn't hold and I hold. Namely, let n be a simple group. H be the group taken twice and G be the Heisenberg group. All the groups are not so big. So, with coefficients in G mod n. Then for this group here, then I hold and draw it down. So for example, if you have any, so if you have only one dimensional disk representations of this group and the sum does not extend at all to the representation of the Heisenberg group. So for each character, you have a unique reducible representation of the whole Heisenberg group, as is typical with this character, but it has rank 10. So, to add that on. Then, moreover, now let me give us a proposition, so the following, so state that suppose with this notation, H is really the example would be again on the table. Suppose H is really on some variety X, and so this extension, the extension of the Heisenberg group, gives us an element in H2, right? So the extension defines an element in H2 of H with coefficient in M. Let's say, let's choose a character. So H star, choose a character. Then, by pullback from the classifying space, it gives us an element from H2 of Y, where Y is the quotient with coefficient in K star. Coefficient in G mod n. That would say like that. Coefficient in G mod n, not sorry. Coefficient in G mod n. And then this gives us, by taking the Bochstein operator, an element in H3 of Y to coefficient in Z torsion. So this was just a line to define some element in torsion in set, yes, also suppose that K equals C. So if you have a free action on the group Z mod n times Z mod n on some variety X, then on the quotient you get a canonical element in H2 with coefficient Z mod n based on this extension given by Heisenberg. And then you can take this Bochstein, obtaining an element here. And so now suppose that this Bochstein is non-zero. And you can build by hand naively a lot of examples like that. So now the claim is that then is not the same. Yes. We got the extended quotient. In this case, the extended quotient looks very easy. And actually, the reason here, is that, the order, you can take K1 topological, now I put the topological still, of, let's call it, S. Q1 topological of the left hand side in this direction is strictly smaller than torsion in Q1 topological. It's strictly smaller than torsion in Q1 topological of the right hand side.
So that should be smooth here, right?
Yeah, I'll like smooth, right? Smooth, let's get projection. Yeah, some projection. because otherwise this is a strange thing. So the reason that non-trivials are the same, well, using, I think it's a Broom spectral sequence and self spectral sequence, you can calculate Polish-Bucke key group, analyze its torsion and one of the ethics. And the reason behind this is that this category, can, so it was also explained in Gilligan's work that in this case, G and sheaves are next, they compose, they correspond to twist sheaves, sheaves over as well algebra on Y, which is a quotient. And sheaves on Azuma algebra Y by Bernard Dirac correspond to sheaves on Severian graphs through Y. So the reason is that in this case, actually, I mean G of X just equals the class of a variety S, where S is a Severian graph Q. And so that, in order to calculate Q1 topological, one calculates Q1 topological Severian graph Q, one can do some machine learning, quite by chance, and then see this.
Seriously, you should say that there is another homomorphism from this K0 of EG geometric.
Yeah, I should have said it. So, I should have said it that when I say K1 topological, so I claim that, yes, it is a well defined homomorphism. That's not what I said. We use it here, that from K0 of geometric EG categories, okay, the well defined homomorphism, say, to real numbers, which sends EG category. Geometric to the logarithm of the torsion in this case K0 of the topological. And this is the place where we use that is geometric, because otherwise one does have topological groups of the G categories by block, but we want to have logarithm of the torsion, so we want the torsion to be finite, which is not
normal. The cardinality of the torsion. Cardinality of the torsion.
Yeah, we want it to be finite, so we, in his work, it's nothing similar to. And the very final remark is that Carole, actually, was the primary motivation for all this, that Gaussian-Schindler conjecture follows from this, which is stated as follows, that the motif is at a function, given x, any variety, so one can consider one has a zeta function defined by Kapranov, and it's natural to try to define something similar, but without taking the course, without taking symmetric groups, courses of symmetric groups, symmetric powers, but by considering equivariant things. So one can similarly define a categorical zeta function similar to Kapranov. And the question by Galkin and Schindler was to compare it to the usual motifs of the function by Kapranov, and the conjecture by them was that this is a product, this is mu applied to the product or this of that motif of S T to I. So where I divided that of S T by the mean sum of classes of as with the power of x to the yes, so this is an element in K0 of varieties power series of T, and this is an equality in K0 of these categories. They are satisfied?
Yeah, you said something earlier.
No, I said, so this follows from the theory.
Right, but this is not obvious, these conditions.
Well, it is almost obvious, yes, yes. Yeah. Well, one needs to look at this letter, right, decompose it into a quantity of graphs. Yes, it's direct, straightforward. So it follows, yeah, zero lines. Okay, thank you very much.
More questions from one?
So the group is abelian, this cannot you cannot give counter examples of this type when the group is abelian.
Which of them?
This said it, he said that the Heisenberg would be a billion of this.
If G is a billion?
Yeah.
Ah, if G is a billion, is there automatic?
If G is a billion?
Maybe I still need to observe.
If G is a billion, you have just relations to zero. It is a billion, if G is a billion. So you have just any migration. So suppose it's a very close field. And then I think this is also here, yeah, this is also satisfied here. Yeah, so all these conditions are automatic.
What about reduction groups?
I don't know. As far as I said, it's even open in the domain. So by Mr. Lee, it was written that he has no idea how to generalize the reduction. I don't know.
For reduction groups, you don't have a compact generator for the category, so it's not available.